Graphic Audio, a movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Vatta's War by Elizabeth Moon. Vatta's War, Book 1. Trading in Danger, Part 2. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Barbara Pinolini, Jonathan Watkins, Lily Beacon, James Lewis, Andy Clemence, Joe Brack, David Coyne, Tim Getman, Stephen Carpenter, Tom Simpson, Colleen Delany, Christopher Graybill, Michael Glenn, Terence Aselford, Michael John Casey, Sonny Lasskey, Mort Shelby, Yasmin Tuazon, Eric Messner, Thomas Penny, Casie Platt, Dylan Lynch, James Konicek, Laura Quinn Anderson, Ken Jackson, and Richard Rowan.
The faces in the crew rec space of the freighter Glennis Jones were all pale. The most senior looked at least 10 years older than he had before. Sergeant Callie Pitt of the Mac and C Military Assistance Corporation undogged her faceplate and ran it back. Let them see a human face. They needed that right now. They had undoubtedly heard the shots that had been fired. They stared at the blood on Pitt's boots and legs. With her faceplate open, she could smell it.
I'm Sergeant Pitt. Your crewman Skeldon tried to ambush us. He's dead. Your captain is alive but injured. I've called in a medical team.
How bad is she hurt? Can't I go see her?
We don't know yet. She's unconscious, and my training says not to move unconscious patients. Tell me about the medical facilities on this ship.
Well, we have a med box for minor emergencies.
No regen tanks? No trauma suite?
No. We don't. We didn't ever need them. Please, let me go see her.
Known her long?
Since she was little. First time she came aboard ship with her dad, I was a second shift cargo handler. Not on this ship, of course. She was maybe hip high on him then, trailing after her older brother.
Good kid. Quiet type. Did everything right.
Kai? I wouldn't say that exactly. Not the quiet part. Good, yes. But no sugar, baby. Honest. Sometimes too honest. That's why...
His mouth snapped shut abruptly, as if he'd almost said something he meant not to.
I want the medics to see her first. Best not move her. Best wait a bit. Someone's with her, monitoring vital signs. You just sit tight.
Gary nodded, mouth clamped on something he didn't want her to know. She sent Jeff to check out the galley, where, as per orders, the weapons the crew had listed were laid out on the table. He popped the video to her helmet display. Two pistol bows. She hadn't seen pistol bows in a long time. Some knives, including the obvious kitchen cutlery. All that was by the book. The crew lockers were by the book. No hidden weapons, and only the personal effects you'd expect from experienced crew on a ship they didn't expect to be on that long. Spare ship suits, a properly primed, good-quality pressure suit for each, shore clothes, entertainment cubes and discs and viewers and players. Someone was studying for a higher rating in space drives and had the study cubes. Someone else had yarn and needles and a half-completed sweater. Little keepsakes, not worth much. They'd have the good stuff back home somewhere in Vatta transport storage if they had no permanent residence. None of the crew were trouble but the one who'd died. That made sense. Gil reported the medics were coming through the lock.
Here's what you're going to do. You know your captain's hurt. You know our medics are coming to work on her. As long as you do what you're told, she'll be fine. Cross us up, and she'll die. Clear?
The crew all nodded, looking solemn and worried, just as they should.
Go back to your compartments and lie down on your bunks. If we need you to do something, you'll be told. In fact, who's on galley duty?
I am.
Small, dark-haired woman. Mihar Mahar, engineering fifth. Someone raised a hand. Mitt Gossen, environmental section first. So they mixed sections on galley duty. Interesting. Many ships rotated it by sections. And she wanted the section firsts available.
Mihar.
The woman looked startled to find that Callie knew her name.
Mr. Gossen, you're a section first. You need to stay loose. Mihar, they'll be sending over ration packs for the boarding party and medics, if the medics stay that long. All you have to do is heat them up. Jeff secured your weapons for the time being. You won't need the kitchen knives. The rest of you, go to your bunks and lie down. We'll keep you informed.
They clambered up awkwardly and moved to the side just as the medics came through with their equipment. Callie had already pointed them to the captain's cabin. They'd had time to replay the vid of the engagement. They didn't need her crowding that small space. When they'd passed, she went on forward to the bridge. There she found two more worried faces. The old woman sitting the comm desk was Quincy Robin, chief of engineering. Almost as old as the ship.
Is she all right?
She's alive. The medics are with her now.
What happened?
Callie explained briefly. Quincy's color came back.
Idiot boys!
Understand you're head of engineering.
Yes.
You reported no functional FTL drive. How did this ship get here with no functional FTL drive?
It failed us coming in. I swear I thought it had 10 more jumps in it, at least, when we left Slaughter Key. But there was a little wobble coming into Belinta, and then it was worse leaving Belinta. And the down jump to Sabine, well, the sealed unit went haywire, and we got cavitation damage downstream.
Huh.
So much for using this ship as a courier, which was what the old man had hoped for. Victor carried spare sealed units, but nothing that would fit on this tub.
We were trying to arrange repairs at the station when you blew the ansibles.
Quincy glared at her. Callie realized that the old woman wasn't scared.
What makes you think we blew the ansibles?
You have the big guns. Nobody else would blow ansibles.
We didn't blow the ansibles. We don't want trouble with ISC.
Then who did?
Don't know. Not us, that's all I know. So, your FTL's out. What about your other systems?
Fine, so far.
The old woman was still angry. Not scared a bit. Well, the old were like that. If they weren't scared of everything. Kai woke slowly as from deep sleep. It didn't feel right. What didn't feel right, she wasn't sure at first. A smell, not the smell of her cabin. Astringent, even medical. She opened her eyes. Above her, too close, was a shiny, curved surface. When she tried to move, her arms bumped into something firm and unyielding. The curved surface lifted away from her face. Now she could see more, and nothing reassuring. Too far away now, the overhead with rows of lights. Too big, the compartment in which she lay enclosed in something uncomfortably like a coffin.
Med box.
Kai struggled to put facts together in a string that made sense.
Med box means... injury. I was injured? When? Where? And this place, what is it?
A face hung over her. She had never seen it before, that she was sure of, if nothing else. Its expression was serious. The mouth opened.
Do you know your name?
Name. What you call yourself. That is your name.
Kai fumbled around in a brain that felt like a basket of wool puffs, until a sharp, angular fact prodded her inquiry.
Name. Your name from him means my name to me. My name is...
Gailara Vatta.
Ah. And do you know where you are?
She looked around as far as she could see over the rim of the med box. For some reason, it seemed more like a ship than a hospital on planet. I'm in a med box. On a ship. I don't know for sure.
Do you know the date?
The whole concept of dates seemed slippery.
No.
No matter. What's the last thing you remember?
Kai didn't remember anything, but she pushed at the gray fuzzballs. Past the screen of her mind ran the equations for calculating oxygen output from a Class 3 environmental system per square meter of reactive surface. So she recited that, and then the ones for calculating drift on downjump.
Think of a person.
She tried, but couldn't remember anyone to think of. Person meant someone like her, like the man leaning over the med box. Suddenly, a cascade of faces appeared on the screen. Her father, her mother, her brother, her uncle, Cousin Stella, Aunt Grace Elaine, Gaspard, the Commandant, Mandy Rocher. The faces combined in scenes, in actions. Then a white streak blanked out everything for an instant, as if lightning had fired inside her head. She was abruptly completely awake, oriented, rememoried, and very, very frightened. She knew what that was. That was a memory module insertion. Someone had her memories on a mod, and they'd just reloaded her brain. Which meant her brain had been, at least, stuck in off, and at worst, completely gorked. And she knew why.
That idiot!
It was a stupid thing to do. I gather you didn't know about it?
No, I didn't know about it. I told them—
We know that much. It was on your recorder. What I'm asking is, did you know he had that crush on you?
No. Not exactly. I knew he was too grateful that we took them aboard, but I thought he'd go for Mihar in the end.
The end wasn't long enough. Here's the situation. You were knocked cold and got a bullet in the arm. The bullet was no problem. The stray needle we took out of your ankle was no problem either. But the head injury was bad enough that we did a pattern extraction and replacement once we'd stopped the bleeding and controlled the swelling.
You're the mercenaries. Mac and C Military Assistance Corporation?
Yes. And you're aboard the Victor, our command ship for this operation. Because your ship lacked the right medical facilities.
My people?
Kai tried to sit up. The med box restraints held her back.
They're all right so far. Now, before you exit the med box, I need to do some final tests of function. Just lie quietly and answer my questions.
She couldn't do anything else. The med box restraints held her, and even if she got her arms loose, she didn't know how to unlatch a med box from inside.
I'm projecting a visual chart above you. What do you see on line 10?
Kai read off the symbols. After that came a color vision test, and a test of depth perception, and then pictures of her crew to see if facial recognition was working. It was. Finally, he unlatched the box, removed the restraints, and helped her sit up. For a moment, she felt dizzy and nauseated, but it passed, and she was simply there, inside a warship's surgery, sitting on the opened case of a med box in a row of med boxes, wearing a pale blue shift with MMAC property stamped on it. Across the wide compartment was another row of med boxes, six with their status lights on, and down the middle, a row of operating tables, shrouded in the hoods that kept them sterile until needed. Kai had not really thought about how much medical treatment a mercenary force might need. For that matter, she hadn't seen this part of a Slaughter Key warship either.
It's as big as a hospital.
War isn't a pretty business. We have 30 med boxes, 10 operating sets, 5 regen tanks, and that's active. We have the stored capacity for field hospitals as well. Now, ready to stand up?
Kai pushed off the edge of the med box. Her knees felt rubbery, but she was able to stand.
Immobilization does that. Nothing we've come up with prevents at least temporary weakness. Now, I'm sure you've got your own medical personnel back home. I'm giving you a cube with details of the treatment you received here, some of which they may want if you need other treatment within the next standard year. Slaughter Key does use standard calendar units, doesn't it?
Yes.
Kai focused on the back home. If they were giving her medical reports for the doctors back home, that had to mean they weren't intending to kill her.
Your arm and ankle responded well to the regen tank treatments. You should, however, do 15 minutes a day of rehab exercise. The details are on the cube. To regain strength at the maximum rate. Your C-spine injury may cause you some difficulty as you get older. I would advise you to consult your medical personnel about a regen treatment when your neural recovery is complete. We've got it stabilized, but I wouldn't be surprised if there were a little soft tissue damage which we couldn't regen because of the primary brain injury.
C-spine injury?
Yes. Luckily, Sergeant Pitt knew enough not to move you until the medics got there, but it's perfectly stable now.
Kai resisted the sudden urge to put her hands up and feel around her neck. It didn't hurt. Nothing hurt, really. But the knowledge that she had been knocked silly and taken off the ship like a bundle of rags, she, the captain, who was supposed to ensure the safety of her ship and her people.
When can I get back to my ship?
I don't know. After the Major talks to you, probably. It's up to command, not to me. You're fit for duty as is. Well, once you get clothes on. I'm afraid your uniform is pretty much gone. Just a moment.
He walked to the far side of the compartment. Kai leaned against the med box she'd come out of and wondered about the six others with lights on. That was easier than wondering what she was going to do now. The man came back with a neatly folded bundle. For the first time, she noticed what must be a name tag stenciled on his tunic. Dubois.
Your ship sent over a clean uniform. You'll want to change, and any moment now you're going to want to use the toilet.
She did, she realized.
Right through there. You can also shower if you like, though the med box does a sonic clean every 4 hours. When you're dressed, come out, and you'll be escorted to the Major's office.
He did not tell her not to try to escape. She could figure that out for herself, and clearly he knew it. Kai took the bundle and retreated through the door marked staff only. Inside, she found three shower cubicles, deep sinks, and a row of toilets. Sonic cleaning or no, she wanted a shower and shampoo, and the brisk water washed away another layer of confusion. When she combed her hair at the mirror above the sinks, she could see nothing of what had happened. Her arm had a pucker scar that looked old, well healed, but no soreness, even when she raised it high overhead. Her ankle's scar was smaller, hardly visible. Her hair seemed shorter. She put on her uniform, the alternate one her mother had insisted she buy. It was annoying even now that her mother had been right. Thankful that whoever had sent it had included underwear. When she'd pulled on the soft-soled ship boots, she felt much more like herself.
I meant to tell you, we don't extend regen to cosmetic results, but that scar on your arm will respond to about 2 hours of regen if you ever want to get rid of it.
It's fine. Thank you.
Kai was annoyed with herself that she hadn't thanked him before.
Quite all right. It was orders, after all.
Thank you, anyway. Clearly you, and others in this place, saved my life.
You're welcome. Corporal Konicek will take you to see the Major.
Corporal Konicek was waiting, armed. Kailara wondered what they thought she could do, that they needed to give her an armed escort. But she walked forward when he gestured.
Captain Vatta, I'm Major Harris. Please, have a seat.
The Major sat behind a desk in a tiny office so bare and tidy that Kai wondered if it was a real working office or just a place chosen to interview hapless civilians. He did not smile.
Captain Vatta, we have a problem.
What is that, sir?
You're aware that someone blew the system ansibles.
Yes.
We didn't do it. We don't blow ansibles. We don't want trouble with the ISC any more than anyone else does. Overcharging, monopolistic pirates they may be, but what they do is essential. And what they do to people who bother their ansibles is exorbitant.
I see.
Naturally, everyone thinks we did it. Warships appear, the ansible platforms blow. Obvious. I'm sure by now the ISC has figured out where we are and is thinking the same thing. The only party who won't believe we did it is the party who actually did it. And so far, no one has claimed responsibility. It would be far handier if the mercenaries were to blame.
I see.
Kai remembered wondering why mercenaries, who depended on Ansible communications as much as anyone else, would risk the serious and permanent annoyance of the ISC. Control of Ansibles was one thing, destruction entirely another.
We have, besides the operation we were hired to perform, several other tasks now facing us. We need to clear ourselves with the ISC before they come barreling in here and blow us up on spec. And we need to house hostages safely in the meantime. lest we incur judgment for their fates as well. We had hoped to use your ship, the smallest, as a courier to the ISC. But I understand that you have no FTL capability.
Right. And we also have a commitment to deliver agricultural machinery now in our holds to Belinta.
Neither of which is possible without an FTL drive. Isn't that correct?
That is correct, yes, sir. Major Harris, if I may ask, would it be possible to obtain a sealed unit from the repair yards on Sabine Prime's orbital station?
Not now or in the immediate future.
Major Harris did not explain why, and Kai was reluctant to ask. He cocked an eyebrow at her.
You're not acting like most civilian captains, Captain Vatta. Most of them try to bluster and scold and command me to do what they want.
It's my first voyage, Major.
I suspect it's more than that. What are you? Slaughter Key Space Service operating undercover?
Me? No, sir.
You're very free with your sirs, Captain Vatta. I don't mind it, but it's reminiscent of a discipline I'd expect to know better than you. Master Sergeant Pitt remarked on your demeanor as well.
Sergeant Pitt?
She's the one who broke your neck and then called the medics. Not your average civ, she said about you. More like an officer candidate. You have something to say, Captain Vatta?
Not really, no. You have an extracted pattern from me, and I don't doubt there was some interrogation while I was in the med box.
And that, too, is not something I would expect a young and inexperienced civ trader to know.
Harris leaned back, hands behind his head.
Look here, Captain Vatta. It's not our practice to harm neutral civilians, which you clearly are. But we have a proposition for you. A proposition that could work to your advantage later. I'm not going to offer that possibility to someone who won't be straight with me.
All right. I was kicked out of the Slaughter Key Space Academy in my last year.
I see. Why?
I trusted someone, a junior cadet, and tried to help him out. He lied to me. He just wanted to make trouble for the government, and my help gave him that opportunity. It embarrassed the Admiral, and I was the handy sacrifice.
That's two young men you've trusted unwisely. If I were you, I'd stop doing it.
Mild as the rebuke was, Kai felt her face going hot. It wasn't fair. She hadn't trusted Skeldon. She struggled with her emotions.
Just a bit of advice I'd give any young officer. Everyone makes mistakes, but not the same ones over and over.
I don't even like them.
Young men in general, or these young men?
These, but they seem so helpless sometimes.
Kai glared at him.
Sorry, but the first thing mercenaries lose is the rescue fantasy thing. My advice is the next time you see someone you think you need to rescue, walk quickly away on the far side of the street. But that's not important. What I have to propose now affects both of us.
And what is that?
All right. We had hoped to use your ship as a courier to the ISC, but since you have no FTL drive, we can't. However, we need a place to stash some neutral civilians who might otherwise give us problems. Your ship is more than adequate for that task. The only problem is that some of them are older than you, and, at least in their own estimation, rank higher. We would prefer to have civilians under civilian command. Saves us work, and prevents certain kinds of problems. But that will depend on you. Simply put, we would like to hire your company to transport, temporarily and in this system, some passengers. For that service, we're prepared to pay standard per diem for an expected duration of that transport.
Harris glanced down at his desk display.
If our calculations are correct, that would come to something in the neighborhood of 250,000 credits.
250,000 credits. That would repay the loan on Sabine Prime and finance the repairs to the FDL drive as well. Kylara tried not to smile.
You do realize we have limited quarters for additional personnel. How many were you anticipating?
Your environmental system will handle a total of 70, isn't that correct?
70? Yes, though that's right at redline. 55's the rated limit, but we don't have the space.
You have cargo holds. Aired up, I'm informed. We'd supply some amenities, pallets and blankets.
My cargo holds are stuffed full of cargo, on contract to the Economic Development Bureau on Belinta.
They'd have to be emptied, or at least enough to accommodate 50 additional passengers, With your present crew, that keeps you under the red line.
Just barely.
Kai could not believe she was arguing with a man who had her completely at his mercy, but Vata's stubbornness held her spine stiff.
And we can't just dump cargo. We have a contract. You understand contracts?
Indeed we do understand contracts, Captain Vata. It is in pursuit of our own contract obligations that we find ourselves in need of your ship, for which we are willing to pay reasonable fees. Do you understand necessity?
Yes, but that cargo—
It's your customer's money. Surely there's insurance.
Actually, no. They had an earlier shipment which was lost by another carrier. Their insurance is not willing to pay on that because the cargo completely disappeared. They hired me to bring them another, but insisted it be on spec.
So it's your money in the holes?
Yes.
Harris stared at his desk display, lips folded under. When he looked up, Kai thought she saw the ghost of a smile in the crinkles by his eyes.
All right, Captain. Here's our best offer. We'll have people help you net your cargo and put a Homer tag on it so you can pick it up later. In fact, we'll help you load it later, and we'll pay the full per diem for those passengers if you command. Otherwise, we'll have to put a military crew on board, in turn your crew and you. We just keep you here until this is over. And where will your cargo be then?
Trade and profit.
Very well. I accept your offer.
Captain Vata, I predict you are destined to have an interesting life. We'll have that contract ready in hard copy in a minute or so, and then, if you're ready, we'll return you to your ship.
I'm ready.
And thank you for not asking more details of our operation. It shows uncommon discretion.
I'm trying to learn, Major.
Slaughter Key should have hung the other fellow out to dry, not you, Captain. They don't know what they're missing. Though your commanders might have had ulcers.
He reached out his hand, and Kai shook it.
Now, let's get over to legal and get that contract signed and sealed, shall we?
The ship's legal offices consisted of a warren of little rooms and one large conference room with a big table. Here, Kai and the Major waited. She noticed that one armed guard still trailed them, but stayed outside the door here, until another officer came in.
I hate these subordinate contracts. Always a mess. Always so many exclusionary clauses.
Senior Lieutenant Mason, this is Captain Vata.
The man extended a damp hand to be shaken.
Captain Vata. Now, I understand you're from Slaughter Key?
Yes, that's right.
Signatories to the Tri-System Revision of the Interstellar Uniform Commercial Code?
Yes.
Well, that simplifies things. Now, do you want to read this yourself, or shall I explain it?
I'll read it.
Since you have no legal representation, I am bound to assist you in understanding anything that might be unclear.
Thank you.
Kai reached for the sheaf of hard copies. He released them with seeming reluctance, and she opened the folder. Familiar terms stared back at her. Consigner, consignee, liability for this and that. She read through, carefully, mindful of lessons learned in the family, that it's the clause you skip over that destroys your profit when you don't fulfill it.
I don't see anything about immunity in case of untoward circumstances not resulting from the negligence of Vata Transport.
They'll be on your ship, under your control. What else?
Natural causes. And it's a war zone. I'm not going to have Vata Transport held liable for stray shots or capture by the other side.
The lawyer gave the Major a long look.
All right. We'll change it. Won't take a moment.
Mason reached for the papers. Kai handed back the one involving carrier liability and held on to the others. He glowered, but walked out with the one sheet.
Lawyers, they're always trying something. Of course, that's why we pay them.
True. Our company's legal staff's the same.
They taught you well, though we don't intend to have any accidents and blow you away.
Good.
They sat in almost companionable silence until the lawyer came back, with a new page 14 that included the missing clause. Kai read it, inserted it, and nodded.
All right, I'm ready to sign.
Major Harris signed for the Mackenzie Military Assistance Corporation, and she signed for Vata Transport Limited. The lawyer signed a line that specified the contract had been prepared in accordance with the Tri-System Universal Commercial Code. Then Major Harris stood up.
Let's get you back to your ship. Your passengers will start arriving in about 6 hours. I'm sending a working party and nets to help with your cargo.
The trip back to Glenys Jones went swiftly. Kai and the members of the working party all wore pressure suits. There was still no way aboard except the little escape vacuum lock. And she sat webbed to the bulkhead in the back of one of the warship's assault shuttles, lurching to and fro with the abrupt changes of acceleration required by a rapid transit. Kai went first through the lock, with two others, and on the inside a guard in armor waved her on up the passage. She came out of the passage to find another guard, this one not in armor. This was a lean woman with close-cropped gray hair and Pit stenciled on her uniform.
You can take your pressure suit off here.
Kai stripped out of the suit. Her ship still smelled like her ship, like home.
Captain Vatta, you look great.
Excuse me?
Sorry, you probably don't remember. I'm Master Sergeant Pitt, and I'm the one who knocked you down harder than I meant to.
Oh, that's all right. And by the way, thanks for calling in the medics.
Kai suspected that for all the fine phrases in the Mac and C advertising, standard operating procedure would have been to finish her off.
Right thing to do. Anyway, they said you were coming back today. I'm glad to see you looking so well.
How are my crew?
Fine. They've all been very sensible and very worried about you.
We now have a contract with Mac and C.
Kai pulled her copy out of her uniform jacket.
Have they told you?
Yep. We're to help unload as many cargo holds as you say we need to, net and beacon the cargo, and then help you through loading passengers. It's your ship, Captain. You tell us what we need to do, and we'll do it. For my sins, I'm your liaison.
Right then. First thing, I want to let the crew know I'm back and functional. Next, we'll get Mitt's assessment of the environmental system and Gary's assessment of cargo. He'll know the easiest and fastest way to unload stuff.
They're waiting in the wreck area. I'll just stay here and organize the working party. They'll need to stay in pressure suits.
Kai went forward to the wreck area. Her crew were scattered around the tables, consuming some meal. She realized she was not oriented to ship's time and didn't know which it was, and talking quietly. No guards stood over them. That much was good. She wondered what to say, but then Quincy looked up and saw her.
Kai! Captain, how are you?
Fine. I don't have an implant, though. What I do have is a contract.
A contract? We thought you were dying!
Luckily, not. Though it was apparently a near thing. I've got my medical records with me, if anyone's that curious. I'd just as soon not look. What they told me was scary enough.
What do you mean by a contract?
Mac and C has hired Vatta Transport to care for some neutral civilian passengers while we're stuck here in this system. I know.
Kai held up her hand to forestall objections.
I know we don't have cabin space or comfortable facilities. I know all that. We're going to net our cargo and put it out with a beacon to pick up later and bed passengers in the cargo holds. First thing, Mitt, is our environmental system holding nominal in all ways?
Yes, Captain.
Good, because we'll be stressing it. They're sending us 50, and they'll be here in about 5 hours. Gary, what's the easiest hold to unload that will hold 50 people for some days? Room for pallets and some exercise space?
Standard configuration. Not stacking bunks, just pallets. And we don't have that many pallets.
They're coming too. Wait, I'll get Master Sergeant Pitt.
Kai was sure Pitt would know how much space to calculate. Pitt did. And in minutes, Gary had figured out the simplest way to unload cargo and take on passengers.
That was the last.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.